the book of Matthew, the 28th chapter, one verse of scripture. He says, go therefore and make disciples. Somebody say, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Give somebody a hug. You may be seated. Our focus today is kingdom discipleship. Kingdom discipleship. Kingdom discipleship. Matthew 28:19. Kingdom discipleship. You see, we hear this verse of scripture regularly. It's not a new scripture. It's not a parable with a hidden truth. It's the words of Jesus to his followers. It's the final instruction that he gives before he ascends. What does it say? Reading from the New King James Version, it says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. How many people have ever heard and or read that verse of scripture? All in the house. If you have heard or read it, raise your hand. I want to see it. Raise both hands. That one's here. Okay, praise the Lord. So it's not a new scripture. Amen. When Jesus says all nations, that word nation comes from the Greek word that means all people groups or a multitude of individuals of the same nature or genus, all people groups. Amen. The word Gentile comes from the same word as nations. The Gentiles were a certain people group. Jews were a people group. So Jesus is saying to go and make disciples of all people groups, blacks, whites, Asians, Latinos, so forth. Go and make disciples of all people groups. And we read in the book of Acts, everywhere that they went, they made disciples. Acts 14 says, and when they had preached the gospel to that city and made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, Iconic, and Antioch. In a parable that Jesus spoke to the Pharisees, in Matthew 13, he said to them, therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storehouse new treasures as well as old. So, my brothers and sisters, if our King, King Jesus, tells us that we are to make disciples, then we need to heed that word and make disciples. Would you think so? One of the major reasons is that when all the people groups have heard the gospel of the kingdom, the Bible says, and then the end will come. Did you hear that? Matthew 24:14, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, people groups, and then the end will come. So discipleship is the most important thing that a believer can engage in after conversion. You didn't like that, did you? God's desire is for those who are saved to become disciples, to bring all life under the lordship of Jesus Christ, but not only to become disciples, but then to help someone else do the same. Somebody say amen to that. See, Paul had this kind of relationship with Timothy. In 2 Timothy 2, Paul said this, "You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore, Timothy, must endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." So in that passage, we learn that Paul discipled Timothy and told Timothy to disciple others. Amen? Y'all with me? Paul helped Timothy to grow from infancy to maturity through the process of discipleship. He didn't just say, "Timothy, come to the Lord, you're on your own." He wasn't satisfied with just witnessing to Timothy, like many of us are. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus. And they come to Jesus and nobody helps them. They get saved and then they sit because those who witness to them are sitting. Amen. And what's sad about that is that this is the area that we as believers neglect the most. We do not take the time or give the time to teach others. We have this gimme, gimme mentality. Teach me, feed me. I'm hungry. What about me? And then when we get whatever we get it, put it in a can, sit on the can. We never in turn give away what was freely given you. Did you know that only 20% of Christian adults, 20% of Christian adults are involved in some sort of discipleship? Oh my goodness. You know what that means? 80% are not discipling other people. 80% of the body of Christ is not doing the number one thing we're supposed to do after conversion. Amen. And when it says that they're not involved in any form of discipleship, only the 20%, I'm not even counting that as one-on-one. That's just any wide range of activity, from attending Sunday school to fellowship groups to spiritual mentors to studying the Bible with a group or reading and discussing a Christian book with a group. Only 20% do that. Oh, me. Only 23% of Christian adults are currently being discipled by someone else. And only 19% are discipling someone else. That's horrible. That means that only 20% of the people On average, in this building right now, only 20% of you are being discipled by someone, and only 19% of you are discipling others. It's sad but true. But listen to this. That's why the Holy Ghost told me to focus on this. After Jesus' resurrection from the dead, and just before he ascended back to heaven, Jesus told his disciples and us what was the most important thing on his mind. Remember now, he's dead, buried, resurrected, and he's given his final address. Talking to those that were following him, he said, now listen now, this is what I need to tell you. Because I'm getting ready to go. It's recorded in Matthew 28. Last words. And he stated in a very clear term what was expected. And he said this, you are to disciple the people of God so they can, in effect, change the world. Wow. Final address. On my way to heaven, then paid the price for you. And here's what I need you to do. Go and make disciples of all people groups. And by the way, I'll be with you always, even to the end of this age. Final address. Why would he make discipleship his final address? He could have talked about heaven. He could have talked about deliverance. He could have talked about money. He could have talked about anything. Could have talked about being faithful. Whatever y'all do, stay faithful. No, his final address, he said, listen, go and make disciples. Wow. So to make disciples and to be disciples was the final end, the final goal that Jesus expected. Brother Jerry, what's a disciple? Just in case, I don't want to assume you know. A disciple is a learner. It's a student. It's an apprentice. Amen. It's someone taking the time to teach and train you in what they know. You know, like your mama taking you in the kitchen and showing you how to cook. She was discipling you in cooking. And you had to pay attention. Put this much salt, this much flour, right? Sprinkle just this much. Bake it just this long. And it came out tasting just like mama's. She was discipling you. You were the learner. Amen. So teaching is always a part of discipleship. You can't be discipled not getting taught. I'm a disciple. Don't come to nobody's class. Ain't in nobody's training. Don't read no books. Don't do nothing. Show up on Sunday and dance and shout and go home and come back the next week. That's not a disciple. Amen. Discipleship ain't a party. Come on, shake your neighbor and say, come on, you need to wake up on this. That's the problem now. Discipleship ain't no party. It's teaching and training and learning and being disciplined. And it cannot be accomplished all at once. You can't go to one class and say, I'm a disciple. No, you're not. better lock in. Walk with someone. Be walked with by someone. Over time. Because we don't, you know, people don't see all our mess in one night. Amen. Need to hang out with you a while. See if you really pray when trouble comes. Or you just ask everybody else to pray for you. Got to walk with you. You listen to me, Jasmine? Got to walk with you. Amen. That's what discipleship is. It's walking with someone. Amen. It's not just sending them a tape. Girl, you need to listen to this. No. It's spending time with them. Help us, Jesus. Let me show you what Paul did in Acts 18. This gives us an example of discipleship. Y'all still with me? Acts 18:11. So Paul stayed there for the next year and a half teaching the word of God. How long you stay? A couple of days. Maybe 15 minutes on the phone. Half hour a month. Now he stayed with them a year and a half teaching the word of God. Being a disciple, my brothers and sisters, is a lifelong process. And the bottom line is each year we should be more spiritually mature than we were the year before. Did you hear that? You can't stay the same and grow. Amen. If you find yourself at the same place you were 6 months ago, 6 years ago, 6 decades ago, you stuck. You're not growing. You're not being discipled. Ought to be further down the road than you were last year. Further up the street. Each year being transformed into the image and the likeness of Christ. You can't cry, can't keep crying, I need Jesus, and you're in the same place in 2017 as you were in 2000. I need Jesus. Now you need discipleship. Need somebody to walk with you that knows how you lie. They know how you procrastinate. They know how you act when trouble comes. Amen. Somebody cares enough about you to walk with you. So when you walk up here in the church and they see you falling out, crying, everybody else think you got Jesus, that you done had an experience with Jesus, and they know, oh, see, that's because of what you did last night. Let me straighten you. Come on, baby, come to the house. Let's talk about how you got there. You're all emotional right now, but that ain't gonna stop you. Let me give you some word. Is this too rough? Paul said to the Romans, for whom he did foreknow, he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Discipleship is about growing. I mean, you look in the mirror, you know if you're growing or just showing. You know, you can fool some of the people all of the time and all of the people some of the time, but you can't fool God. Are you growing? Amen. I mean, think about your children and think about yourself when you was going through school. You couldn't skip 4 years, you know, and then graduate. And because we are so rebellious against growth, The law, the government had to get involved and say, you don't send your kids to school, you're going to jail. Let's look at that spiritually. You don't grow, you're in jail. Because the enemy will lock you up, throw away the key, and you don't know enough word to use the keys of the kingdom to unlock yourself. Amen, somebody. God wants us to grow. And discipleship is the process that he chose. Second Peter says this, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. Grow in grace and in the knowledge. Amen. You don't get knowledge just by listening to songs. I love to dance like the most of them. I like songs too, but they're not helping me grow. Amen. We sing the song, you've been so good. And you cry, yeah, you've been good. Then you go out of here and ain't got no word to stand. That's why you've been so good. Because you ain't done nothing, don't know nothing. And God's grace has just kept you. Oh, yeah. He's been so good to me. Amen. Doing the best I can, DeMarcus. I can't see you. Amen. You got the point, right? Yeah. God has been good. But think about this. Holy Ghost just gave me this. He could be better in your life if you get in his word. Amen. You want good or better? I want better. Better comes with getting in his word. Now think about this. If God will bless you when you ain't doing nothing that he told you to do, how much more will he bless you if you obey him? Amen. You know, we've been skating on grace. Amen. But God wants to do so much more in our lives. Right. We limit God because we don't grow in grace. We don't grow in knowledge. Amen. Ephesians 4 says this, grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. My brothers and sisters, there is so much false teaching in our world. From homosexuality to Jesus having children after the flesh to there is no life after death. I mean, it's just all over the place. And we need to be discipled so we can know the truth. Ephesians 4 says this. When we know the truth, I love this passage. So then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. How about that? God wants you to know the truth to protect you. We need to be discipled so we can understand the truth. There's so many things that we believe that we weren't discipled to believe that in the word. Somebody said it, we heard it, we ran with it. And then when somebody challenges us, they say, that ain't what the Bible says. We ready to get mad. Or even worse, we'll misquote the Bible. You know, the Bible says you take one step, you'll take two. That ain't in the Bible. I mean, we just say stuff that ain't even Bible and say it's Bible. So the enemy comes and tricks us into believing a lie because we haven't been discipled. We think discipleship is just going to church on Sunday. Did you know that the Bible says something so powerful it's almost scary? The Bible says that there are doctrines of men and there are doctrines of demonic teaching in the world to lead us away from the truth of the kingdom. Can I give you a couple of scriptures? 1 Timothy 4 says, now, the Spirit worketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, depart from the faith, depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Listen, there are seducing spirits in the world to seduce us away from the truth. There are doctrines of demons released so that you won't believe the truth. I mean, is Jesus really Lord? Did he really get up from the grave? Did he really ascend to heaven? Is there really a resurrection? You ought to be able to answer all those questions. Is God a woman? I mean, come on, I hear all this stuff. Amen. Well, you do know that I'm a Hebrew Israelite. Well, where's that in the word? This doctrines of demons. Well, I'm not part of the 144,000, so am I still going to heaven? Y'all think that's far-fetched? No. Those are the questions that people sow. Amen. And if you as a believer don't know the answer because you ain't been discipled, then what happens is that goes in one ear, don't go out the other, dances around in your thought life. Then you start running after, well, who the 144,000? How do I get to be part of that number? You're born again. You're a child of God. 144,000 are even dealing with you. That's dealing with the Jewish nation. Amen. You've been born again. You've been sealed by the Holy Ghost. But if you don't know, amen. Matthew says, but in vain they do worship me. Matthew 15:9, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. Do you know men have commandments that ain't got nothing to do with God? I said men have commandments have nothing to do with God. Y'all still with me? Yeah. Raise your right hand. Heavenly Father, I'm listening to your word today. And it ain't falling on deaf ears. Amen. I hear you, God. All right, you hear it then. Amen. And my brothers and sisters, without discipleship, many are being led astray. Did you hear me? Many are being led astray without discipleship. Now, I want you to understand that in context of what I said earlier. Only 23% of the people in this room, amen, are being discipled. And only 19% of you are discipling somebody else. Now think about that in light of the fact that many are being led astray. Why? Because they're not being discipled. Why aren't they being discipled? Because 80% of the people in the body of Christ ain't discipling nobody. You wonder why we got so much false doctrine and so much garbage going on in our world. Wonder why so many believers are so torn on so many different things. But yet the number one thing Jesus said for you to do after conversion is make disciples. I don't get it. Many are being seduced by false teaching. Many. Paul said this to the Corinthians. He said, listen, 2 Corinthians 10, we destroy arguments and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God and take every thought captive. Amen. To obey Christ. Who does that? The believer does that. We do that. We destroy arguments. But you can't destroy argument when you don't know the truth. And you ain't gonna get the truth by watching television. Amen. Or surfing the internet. Don't you know you got people out there on the internet that are on the internet. You got people out there on the internet that are spewing out stuff that ain't got nothing to do with the Bible. They're sowing seeds of doubt and unbelief. But when you know the truth you know will set you free. Help us, God. Discipleship helps us to develop the skill to overcome the enemy, to overcome his suggestions. Amen. So you gotta be walking with somebody. You gotta be. And someone needs to be walking with you to help you to develop. God didn't call you and put you on an island by yourself. He gave you the body of Christ. He gave Jesus, when he ascended, gave you gifts to help you grow. The apostle and prophet, the evangelist and shepherd and teacher, so that you can be equipped, prepared to do what he has called you to do. But it's through discipleship. So when you think about it, saint, believer, man and woman of God, are y'all listening to me? Look at me. Amen. I want your attention. So when you think about it, I want you to think about this. Don't raise your hand and don't nod your head so people can say, oh, you do. No, just be real still and look straight ahead. Is there a person in your life? I ain't talking about your kids. You ought to be raising them. Is there a person in your life that you are intentionally walking with in the things of God, the word of God? Wait a minute now. For this purpose, to move them from infancy to maturity. Are you walking with someone to help them move from infancy to maturity? Now, I ain't talking about somebody you talk to on the phone once a month. Jesus stayed with his disciples for 3 years. Amen. Who are you walking with? Well, Brother Jerry, I don't know enough to be to make disciples. Are you born again? You know what you know. Take that and begin to share that based on what you've learned. Well, what if they ask me a question I can't answer? Tell them I'll get back with you. Discipleship doesn't mean know everything. That's why it's a process. Stop excusing yourself out of the process. Stop excusing yourself out of the process. It was the most important thing Jesus said. I'm leaving, but I want you to go and make disciples of all people groups. Because you know that Jesus was not racist. Amen. He didn't tell you, just go to the black people. Now just go to the white people. Just go to the Asians. He never said that. He said all people groups. All means all to me. All nations. And we think that meant go to all nations. We thought that meant leave America and go somewhere else in some other country. Don't you know that your neighborhood got nations in it? Amen? Amen? You got various people groups on your street. You go to your job, you got various people groups. We automatically think that means I got to get on a plane or get on a boat and go across seas somewhere because I've been called to the nations. That, you know, your nation might be your neighborhood. I know y'all didn't like that. We like the glory of travel. Your nation may be your job. Because you got all people groups at your job. My brothers and sisters, it takes time to grow. But as you grow, you have to enable someone else to grow. God wants us to grow and then teach others. I'm going to close with this verse, Hebrews the fifth chapter. It's my closing verse. Somebody say closing verse. This is my closing verse. Hebrews the fifth chapter, starting at verse number 12, it says this. I love this passage. It says, you have been believers so long now that you ought to be teaching others. Instead, you need someone to teach you again the basic things about God's word. You are like babies who need milk and cannot eat solid food. He goes on to say, for someone who lives on milk is still an infant and doesn't know how to do what is right. 14 says, solid food is for those who are mature, who through training have the skill to recognize the difference between right and wrong. So we should be moving towards maturity and helping others move as well. We're citizens of the kingdom of God. Someone doesn't know that. We have a kingdom mandate. Someone doesn't know that. We have the keys of the kingdom. Someone doesn't know that. We have kingdom rights. Someone doesn't know that. There's healing power in the name of Jesus. Someone doesn't know that. There's victory in the Lord. There's forgiveness for your sins. Someone doesn't know that. But you do. Who are you discipling? Stand to your feet. All right? Look at somebody and say, I'm all right, I'm all right. I'm all right after that, I'm all right. It was tough, but I'm all right. That was a pill to swallow, but I'm all right, I'm all right. I'm all right. Because I'm going to make disciples. I'm going to make disciples. I'm going to make disciples.